By now, we're all familiar with the concept of parallel universes, right? In fact, those of you who are familiar with the SCP Foundation, or maybe even longtime fans of the videos on this channel, will know that there are multiple universes that exist besides our own. There might even be those of you out there with such refined knowledge that you could even name some of the various different universes and dimensions that the Foundation has come into contact with over their years studying anomalies. Today, we're taking a look at one such anomaly, an interdimensional wormhole connecting an alternate universe known as SCP-1322, or by the somewhat questionable nickname, the Glory Hole. And no, not the one in the airport bathroom in Minneapolis. Get your head out of the gutter. Let's take you back to 1952. Imagine you're a researcher working for the SCP Foundation. It's August, and a new anomaly has been discovered. It's a stabilized breach in the very fabric of space-time, an aperture into a completely different universe than the one you know. A month later, the Foundation has managed to secure control around this new SCP-1322, establishing Site 122 around the breach. Given that this wormhole has a fixed position and doesn't seem to move at all, in only another month's time, you watch as a metal cylinder one day appears, as if from nowhere, pushed through SCP-1322 by someone, or something, on the other side. Naturally, there's a buzz among you and your fellow researchers. What is this thing? Is it dangerous? How did it get here? The cylinder is sent off and quarantined, then sterilized so that it can be safely examined. Upon closer examination, it turns out it's a hollow container with a screw cap, almost like a thermos flask. And inside, a number of triangular sheets of what appears to be paper with strange glyphs written on them. It's a message in a bottle from a completely separate reality. The months go by and experiments involving SCP-1322 are in full swing. But while you were probably expecting there to be full-scale explorations through the wormhole, your job as a researcher seems to just be throwing objects attached to rope through SCP-1322. In fact, the most exciting that those early experiments got was taking atmosphere samples from the other side of the wormhole. Even then, you only learn that there's very little different about the other dimension's atmosphere when compared to normal Earth levels, apart from a slightly higher concentration of argon in the air. Unfortunately, despite even more of the metal cylinders appearing through the wormhole, very little remarkable happens with SCP-1322 over the course of the rest of the year. It's not until July 1953, almost an entire year after the anomaly was first discovered, that the Foundation's linguistic experts finally make a breakthrough studying the strange glyphic messages. The first exciting thing to happen with this wormhole, and it was some other department that uncovered it. What a bummer. Thanks to the help of their in-house linguistic and mathematical experts, the Foundation determined that the glyphs were some form of cordial, friendly greeting, but using geometric components with written language. Imagine if math and written words had a baby. No, not your algebra homework. Anyway, using the same system of communication, the Foundation's linguists sent a reply back through SCP-1322 in one of the metal containers. And then, nothing. No more messages. For 3 whole months, the wormhole fell silent. The only thing breaking that lapse in contact was a light that appeared to activate on the far side of SCP-1322. Observations revealed that somebody seemed to have constructed a new containment chamber, but on the other side of the wormhole. In October of 1953, the SCP Foundation finally began extensive communication with those on the opposite side of SCP-1322. Through the frequent exchange of written messages, research teams learned that the glyphs were a common system of nonverbal communication in this alternate universe, a place that soon became known as SCP-1322-A. Members of this dimension's civilization soon started to pick up and incorporate English into their correspondence with the Foundation, until they were eventually able to set up a telegraph that used a specially shielded cable running through the wormhole, allowing those in dimension SCP-1322-A to talk to the SCP Foundation on the other side. The civilization that existed beyond SCP-1322 was apparently a society of human beings, almost identical to the people of our own universe. The people that the Foundation was in direct contact with on the other side were members of a scientific organization that had been tasked with handling the area that surrounded SCP-1322 in their universe. Not too dissimilar from the Foundation themselves, by the sound of it. However, the biggest dissimilarity between the inhabitants of each parallel world was their different levels of scientific understanding. What do we mean by that? Well, like many in our universe, the Foundation scientists on this side had a pretty well-rounded and balanced understanding of biology, physics, and chemistry. But those in SCP-1322-A were part of a civilization that had a far more in-depth understanding of only physics, with a far less knowledge of biological science than we might have. The SCP-1322-A inhabitants had made many great strides in the fields of mathematics and high-energy physics, and this had enabled their civilization to possess a level of technological and engineering sophistication that people in our world could only dream of. And yet, they were hindered by how little they understood basic biology, such as how aspects of nature and human bodies work. The people of SCP-1322-A expressed a strong interest in exchanging samples of music, art, literature, and mathematics with the Foundation, but seemed to have no interest in religion or medicine. And so the exchange went on, with the denizens of SCP-1322 sharing detailed records of their advanced astronomical observations, encouraging the Foundation to emulate their deep space findings. That must have been nice, essentially getting a cheat sheet or a things to look out for in space guide from an advanced alternate universe. Or it would have been nice if the data the Foundation received from the other side actually lined up with our own observable universe. The Foundation flagged this issue up with the SCP-1322-A, and they responded by saying that personnel should have more candor in the future if their civilizations were to continue sharing scientific findings. Needless to say, tensions were beginning to emerge between these two different universes. Following lapses in communication from their side, the inhabitants of SCP-1322-A reported that there had been some form of viral outbreak in their universe. This had seemingly spread from members of their own organization, infecting the area surrounding SCP-1322, and ultimately leading to the local government imposing quarantine measures. The Foundation offered to assist, asking for a sample of this virus, which they then received. Analyzing it, they learned it was nothing more than a harmless variant of the common flu, and worked with SCP-1322-A to create an antidote. Now, the flu might not sound all that bad, but remember, beyond that little wormhole was a universe that hadn't made anywhere near the advances in biology that we have. SCP-1322-A didn't have vaccines or treatments to deal with an infection like this. And so, when this flu virus found itself in their world, perhaps through a message that was passed on to them through SCP-1322, it was able to cause widespread fatalities. 8 million, almost 10 whole percent of SCP-1322-A's population was killed by the outbreak. Gradually, however, the Foundation was able to help them get it under control. But that wasn't the end of their troubles. After successfully inoculating their world against the virus in October of 1973, SCP-1322-A reported that there had been an unexpected decrease in pregnancies. The following year, the birth rate had dropped significantly, which was then found to be an unexpected side effect of the vaccine the Foundation had given to SCP-1322-A to stop the flu. According to them, this had the knock-on effect of creating widespread social disorder. In January of 1975, when the Foundation once again offered the people of this alternate universe assistance, they were met with the response, "No, thank you. You have done enough." Later that same year, some new management assumed control of the organization on the other side of the wormhole. They maintained an open line of communication with the Foundation, but in a far more aggressive manner, almost as if they were accusing them of the troubles now faced by their world. There was massive upheaval across their globe, with less than 1,000 live births between July and September of 1975. During that time, the organization refused to exchange any further scientific or cultural information with the Foundation, and eventually, in October 1975, it severed ties completely. They sent a final communication condemning the SCP Foundation, stating, "You killed us. You did this to us. In your carelessness and your arrogance, you have destroyed our posterity, but we shall avenge. We of the last generation pledge and vow this. We will find a way. After that, things were quiet. A few stray pathogens made their way through SCP-1322, but were swiftly destroyed before they could spread. Then, in January 1977, a high-energy particle beam was fired through the wormhole at Foundation staff. It caused minor damage to the containment chamber, but this was repaired. The same thing would happen again in 1984. A high-energy blast, this time was followed by more of the pathogen being sent through the wormhole. And so it went on. Every few months, the people of SCP-1322-A would try to attack the Foundation like this, and each time the attempt was futile. Any damage the beam caused was repaired, and any pathogens were quickly isolated and destroyed. In 1991, the Foundation tried filling the containment chamber housing SCP-1322 with quick-setting ceramic, perhaps to bury the wormhole for good. But a month later, their former allies on the other side released a solvent that ate through the ceramic. They then tried changing up their tactics, firing the particle beams still, but now also beginning to send nanobots, microscopic robots, through SCP-1322. But once again, the Foundation was able to negate any damage that these devices could do. These two neighboring universes, home to organizations that had once tried to share knowledge, were now engaged in an endless stalemate, a war with no winner. A device fell through the wormhole in March of 1995, which upon activation started to heat up the atmosphere inside the SCP-1322 containment chamber. The air quickly became superheated plasma, causing considerable damage until it was then vented from the chamber. The Foundation had taken their biggest hit from SCP-1322-A in over a decade, and were forced to seal the wormhole in an altered atmospheric conditions, keeping it essentially within a vacuum, where nothing, not even air, could exist. 3 years later, the people of SCP-1322-A sent another delightful gift to their adversaries, a miniature nuclear weapon. This almost decimated Site-122, but the damage was once again repaired, and the threat contained. Next, in 2006, the residents of the other universe tried pumping corrosive acid through the wormhole, once again causing considerable damage to the containment chamber on the Foundation's side. The following year, the Site-122 administrator instructed Foundation personnel to send a probe through SCP-1322, perhaps to get a better idea as to what sort of state the neighboring universe was in after all this time. A series of 8-kilo iron rods were fired through the wormhole, however, destroying the probe before it could reach SCP-1322-A. They tried again in 2008, this time with a unique gas that rapidly changed into a solid state of matter after it passed through SCP-1322. This filled the containment chamber, putting pressure on the structure and threatening to tear it apart from the inside. Then the substance condensed after damaging the SCP-1322 containment chamber, and more pathogens and nanobots were introduced. The goal was to probably spread them further out of the chamber to the outside world, but the Foundation was able to prevent this. Finally, SCP-1322-A's last attack involved a barrage of micronuclear warheads, multiple high-energy particle beams, and an onslaught of pathogens and nanobots. But, of course, the Foundation had no trouble containing this attack and repairing the damage it caused. The story of SCP-1322 is an example of the old saying, "The road to hell is paved with good intentions." You can start out with a noble goal, say, sharing your scientific knowledge with another universe, even helping them cure the flu. But sometimes, something unforeseen can go wrong and turn former friends into bitter, unforgiving enemies. These two warring universes are condemned to continue this sad and deadly dance until all the lights go out in one or both of them forever.